Well, let's bring in the national chairman of the Action Democratic Party, Yabaji Yusuf Sani. He's an engineer. Let's first begin with the political developments from the Southwest. Here we saw the Southwest leaders talking about true federalism and that's the panacea to curing insecurity. And of course, the secessionist agitator Sunday Igboho, outrightly put or turned down by the governor of Ondo State that, hey, we're not supporting anything that is going to tear the fabrics of the Nigerian nation apart. What are your thoughts here?
Well, I'm not surprised. Southwest is a very active, dynamic political space in the context of Nigerian politics. If you look at it from the Second Republic, even at that time they were calling for something similar to this, confederation, they called it that time. And it was a very loud, mantra from the Southwest. So, and then even coming to all the demonstrations we have had, even when Obasanjo was there, you had OPC, the executive OPC, and then the Gani Adams OPC. And then, so Southwest is a very, very active, dynamic political, entity in the context of Nigerian politics. So what is happening today to me is just another dimension, that will probably awaken the rest part of Nigeria to know that politics is now 2023 is already here. It's all about 2023. It's just to why I'm telling you is that it has served Southwest well to keep things on the boil. It happened when the military was about to quit the scene. Mm. The power was given to Southwest of the Platter of Gold by the military, because they kept the polity on the boil, and in order to cool things down and have a safe landing for the military, they made it such that no other party or no other zone really was in the reckoning of the context that we had at that time. So what is happening today to me is nothing new.
But let's look at the communique issued. There's a major plank of that communique is that true federalism, which you've tried to explain, is it capable of solving the insecurity problems?
No, the insecurity problem is a different kettle of fish.
But they are saying that federalism,
true
federalism is a political jargon. That's a political jargon, as far as I'm concerned. Because when you talk to, it depends on who you are talking to about true federalism. So it's a political gimmick people use to now address other issues that have really no connection with what you are talking about. Insecurity to me in Nigeria is consequences of failure of leadership, which you can place squarely on the doorsteps of the APC-led government. A situation where you cannot provide for the citizens of this country the basic needs. Unemployment is the order of the day, the banditry. You have a situation where budgets year in, year out, that are made in trillions. Governors will come to Abuja, take their own cut, go back to their states, sit down round table, distribute it amongst themselves. They will not allow even the budget that should go to the local government, tier of the where people will have feel the impact of it. Perhaps if they were allowing such things to happen, that money that should have gone to people that will go to repair roads, build hospitals, fund education, infrastructure development, perhaps if the governments were wise and were allowing this money to trickle in to address this fundamental human needs, maybe you may not have the issue of insecurity the way you have it today. Because what the people, the citizens are saying is that we see you riding,
bubbles, convoys,
convoys and things like that. Your family is.
So you're saying it goes beyond what the federal can do. The state has its own responsibility.
Every sector, every element in the power structure we have in this country today has, especially, I'm talking about the state now, not the individuals that you are trying to push the blame to. You know, they are playing the victim. The government is playing the victim. You know, that's, you know, so that's why those who are talking about to divert attention that, oh, true federalism, what have you.
It's just divert attention.
Restructuring. Let me tell you. If you want to be political, yes, I can talk about this. But if you want to be realistic, the constitution of this country that we have today is a living document. Why do I say so? It's because you refuse or you fail to address the fundamental issue of how you recruit leadership. If you keep on recruiting people that have questionable characters in your National Assembly and the government, you know, in the government houses that you have, of course you cannot have any impact, and people will be asking for, where are we? Where do I belong? Where is the government? Where is the dividend of democracy that they talk about? Because they are receiving nothing in terms of the dividend of democracy that should go to the people. So it is, there's nothing wrong with what you have. I'm not saying, and to even bolster what I'm saying, the constitution itself provides for amendments.
Which is what we're seeing right now. I do know that there's a constitution review committee.
Yes, you see, people are just trying to muddle up things.
Okay. You know. So what you're saying in general is that it's a systematic issue beyond individuals and all of that. But you know what? At the end of the day, we're seeing this whole calls for secession get louder and louder.
Because
we're seeing it from different regions. We've seen, you know, the Southwest. We've seen the Southeast, and we're even seeing more regions push for that. But my question to you right now is, the government at the center, is it handling it properly before it spirals out of control?
Is there any government at the center?
Well, there is a government. We do have
But there's no governance. That's what the Nigerians are telling you, because there's no governance. That's why everybody is shouting that, oh, please let us go to where we can feel comfortable. You know, because there's no governance.
So now, how should this be handled before it falls, you know, out of the hands of even those in charge?
No. What should happen is that this system we're operating, the democratic system we're operating, of governance we're operating, has a lot of provisions to address the issues we're talking about today, so that you don't unnecessarily bring down the roof, you know, on this beautiful system of governance. I haven't seen, there's yet to be invented or discovered another system of government that allows you and me and every other person to have a say and have a feel of governance. But in Nigeria, we turn things upside down. It's like a pyramid standing on its head. That's why everything is crumbling. It can't stand, because there's no leadership, you know, at the center. And the system we're operating presupposes that you will have an effective leadership at the center. You also have an effective leadership in the other sectors, like local government, you know, tier, the state tier. You will have effective leadership that will respond to the needs of the citizens. But that is not happening in Nigeria. And why is it not happening? Because we elect wrong people. We have a wrong system of election. And look at what's happening. Look at what the center you're talking about. Look at what they're doing to the electoral bill that will have addressed the fundamental issue that is the problem of this country, which is people you elect. If you elect corrupt people, you are going to have corrupt government. And that's what is happening today. Every day you open your newspaper, if you care to investigate or to find out, go to NMPC, go to NEMASA, go to MPA, go to any agency of the government. You will find huge, horrendous, you know, endemic corruption inside the system. And you say that's governance?
So you're actually indicting the government of the APC, because I know that, you know, part of the main thing
is facts and figures. With facts and figures.
It's fighting corruption, improving the economy, insecurity. Where
is fighting corruption? Which corruption are they fighting? Fighting corruption that if you want to employ somebody in even the security agencies are talking about today, you have to pay. To get promotion in this government, you have to pay.
So, as citizens,
so how do you fight corruption?
These
are quite outlandish.
They are, but they are happening.
And we must bring them out
so that the government should sit up, so that they should know that people are watching what they are doing. That is the role of opposition. Okay. We must bring these things up for them to change. We are not happy. We want you to succeed. I'm not saying it for government to fail. I'm saying this so that they can wake up. Perhaps they have few months to go.
But Nigerians, you look at the opposition. The opposition in Nigeria is almost non-existent because we're not seeing as much push, you know, from the opposition to really challenge the government and the center to
opposition,
do more.
The opposition,
in dealing with the issues bedeviling the nation.
The opposition, whenever the opposition is given
you're
a chance,
you're part of the opposition.
Exactly.
And you are
whenever,
a national chairman
whenever,
of the party.
Whenever you give us opportunity like this, we'll really bring out issues that will address. Because
I'm more focused beyond criticizing the government at the center. Let's provide solutions. Because
solutions?
At the end of the day, Nigerians need to experience good governance
solutions?
To see progress in the nation.
Solutions.
So the opposition, what
solutions
are you proposing?
Solutions are
to
that
issues?
Your president should engage with you. When your president lost his number one, army officer, he should appear to be sympathetic. He should show it the empathy so that it will now energize the rest rank and file to really fight for this country. That is what governance is about. It's not about locking yourself up in where you have as a government house. No, that's not what the government is all about. It's about you showing empathy. Tell us that you are with us.
But he sent his condolences, you know, and describing the late general and the other gallant officers.
Other president I read, other president from United States, from US, from where I sent condolences. This is our president. Nigerian president. You appointed this man. He died under some circumstances that nobody can ever explain today. You know, the only thing that this president can do is to show empathy to the families of these people that unfortunately were involved in this. And that is leadership failure that I'm talking consistent with leadership failure. And you are saying good governance, you say you want it to fail. It's our president, President Buhari, must rise to the occasion.
You know,
he has failed to rise to the occasion whenever it is demanded. Look at when NSAS happened. Come and give Nigerians speech. It was flat. Look at what happened. This unwarranted or not needed waste, you know, of our precious assets, because your human capital is a precious asset. Most precious assets, even the ones that you are spending billions on, like your military, you know. So when a top officer like that, you know, is lost, what do you do as a president? You don't just sit in your villa and start saying that, oh, I'm sorry, this is a mortal blow to the belly of our world. Who cannot say that?
Should we be worried about the frequent crashes, or is it a matter of the type of aircraft? I know you are not an aircraft engineer, but at least you still, you know, work in that realm.
But even the man on the street will tell you that how can these aircrafts that are performing in other climes be falling out of the skies in such a frequency? In 3 months, I think we have got about how many now? Three or so. Mm-hmm. You know, and each one of them will go with what I call the precious assets of this country. They are wasted, apart from the money that we have wasted, you know, even
on the machines.
So the fact of the matter is that something is wrong. And what is wrong is not with the aircraft, it's with the people. And who do you hold responsible? Your government, of course, because that's why you elected the government. It's not for them to play victim. No. You know, we are the victims. And government should be held responsible. They should be held accountable because they are supposed to ensure that we have the proper maintenance culture in that place. It's non-existing. That's what hasn't shown. Or it's a sabotage against the system.
It's a good thing that the manufacturers of the aircraft, that's the Beechcraft 350, they are coming to Nigeria to really
investigate. Well, they better do because before Nigeria gives them a bad name.
Alongside the AIB in Nigeria to ensure that, you know, we find a root cause to why all of these crashes are happening. But for now, I would have to say thank you so much for joining us tonight on the program.